warm afternoon. Who knows what's next? We just have to be ready. You're in the hip hop archive, so there was a song you used to say, I don't have to get ready because I stay ready. I think you should stay ready, okay? Because who knows what's going to happen next. It's my pleasure to welcome Greg Tate. Tate and Greg Thomas to the Hutchins Center and Hip Hop Archive and Research Institute this afternoon as they reanimate the long-running and iconic debate between Ralph Ellison and Amiri Baraka, two of the 20th century's greatest thinkers on art as politics. Many would say that there could be no setting more appropriate for this performance than the Hip Hop Archive, with hip hop's abiding interest in art, politics, dialogue, and debate. 2014 marked the centennial of the birth of Ralph Ellison and the 50th anniversary of Amiri Baraka's Blues People. Tate, to my right, and Thomas, to my left, I couldn't help that, you know, conceived of this piece to commemorate both occasions with an epistolary exchange on the individual and mutual legacies of two of the most important Black American literary men of the 20th century. Greg Tate was a staff writer at the Village Voice between 87 and 2004. In 1985, he co-founded the Black Rock Coalition with the musician Vernon Reed, among others. His books include Flyboy and the Buttermilk, Everything But the Burden, What White People Are Taking from Black Culture, Midnight Lightning, Jimi Hendrix and the Black Experience, and the forthcoming Flyboy 2, The Greg Tate Reader from Duke University Press. He has taught at Yale's Graduate Art Program, Columbia University's Jazz Studies, at Williams College, and at Brown University. The Source named him one of the godfathers of hip-hop journalism for his groundbreaking work on the genre's social, political, economic, and cultural implications. Greg Thomas has written on jazz and culture for The Village Voice, The Root, All About Jazz, Salon, The Guardian, and Callaloo, and was a jazz columnist for the New York Daily News. He was the founding editor-in-chief of Harlem World magazine and hosted jazz radio programs for New York's WBAI and WVOX and the online TV series Jazz It Up. He serves as a consultant for the National Jazz Museum in Harlem and for Jazz at Lincoln Center. He is one of the foremost writers on the great Albert Murray, having contributed to Albert Murray and the Aesthetic Imagination of a Nation, and written, written the afterword to the forthcoming Murray Talks Music, the uncollected music writings and interviews of Albert Murray. This is a unique opportunity, and we are thrilled to welcome Greg Tate and Greg Thomas to the Hip Hop Archive at Hutchins Center this afternoon to engage us and each other in the thoughts of Ralph Ellison and Amiri Baraka. Thank you.
Dear Greg Tate, thanks for agreeing to this exchange, a pursuit of the lessons we can learn from the Ralph Ellison, Amiri Baraka nexus on the blues, jazz, culture, politics, race, class, American identity, and American destiny. At least that's how I see our conversation in letters, which is somewhat a showdown throwdown since I'm taking Ellison's side and you Baraka's. To paraphrase Frederick Douglass, no struggle, no progress. So let's deal with the struggle as portrayed in the life and works of these two gentlemen and determine how we have progressed or not in the wake of their words and actions in the world. Straight up, Ellison kicked Baraka's ass in that February 1964 review of Baraka's Blues People and did it in dashing, signifying fashion. The blues as music and an aesthetic, as a homegrown existential worldview and philosophical anthropology, had been important to Ellison for quite some time. In 1945, when your man Baraka was just 11 years old and still had his birth name, Leroy Jones, Ellison, then 32, wrote what's become a definitive description of the blues. The blues is an impulse to keep the painful details and episodes of a brutal experience alive in one's aching consciousness, to finger its jagged grain, and to transcend it, not by the consolation of philosophy, but by squeezing from it a near-tragic, near-comic lyricism. As a form, the blues is an autobiographical chronicle of personal catastrophe expressed lyrically. That quote from the essay titled Richard Wright's Blues could be the foundation for an entire course at Harvard. And now that we know that Ellison and his longtime main man, Albert Murray, had deep discussions about the cultural power and meaning of the blues and jazz all through the late 40s onward, their exchanges from the 1950s, published in 2000 as Trading 12, the selected editors of letters of Ralph Ellison and Albert Murray, and their fiction and nonfiction overall, clearly display their cosmopolitan ease with the Western tradition of literature, their global view of myth, ritual, and history across the ages, and how these relate to what Ellison called the Negro idiom and Murray termed the blues idiom. Ellison, the man whose 1952 novel, Invisible Man, is, as you well know, a world-class 20th century polyphonic classic, accepted the ancestral and intellectual imperative to define Black American culture and American identity. So he couldn't let your man Jones get away with theorizing the blues, as he put it, straining for a note of militancy with an introductory mood of scholarly analysis that unfortunately, quote, frequently shatters into a dissonance of accusation. Ellison thought that Jones's blues people was too burdened by sociology, and that in musical turn, his pitch was at times too sharp, at others too flat. Quote, one would get the impression that there was a rigid correlation between color, education, and the Negro's preference in music, Ellison wrote. Then he makes a signature Ellisonian move, whereby the thesis of the singular and the antithesis of the complex synthesize into the exceptional. Ellison. But what are we to say of a white-skinned Negro with brown freckles who owns 16 oil wells sunk in a piece of Texas land once farmed by his ex-slave parents, who were a blue-eyed, white-skinned, red-headed Negro woman from Virginia and a blue-gummed, black-skinned, curly-haired Negro male from Mississippi, and who not only sang bass in a holy roller church, played the market and voted Republican, but collected blues recordings and was a walking depository of blues tradition. Jones's theory no more allows for the existence of such a Negro than it allows for himself. But that concord of sensibilities which has been defined as the meaning of culture allows for much more variety than Jones would admit, end quote. Ellison thought that such limitations resulted in Jones giving the blues the blues. Jones's class analysis obscured the crucial need to connect American Negro culture to American culture overall. Ignoring this intricate network, Ellison wrote, would be like attempting, quote, delicate brain surgery with a switchblade. Ouch. I await your response.
Now, gee, nobody loves Ralphie's all-seeing, all-knowing, ratiocinating novelist brain like moi. Invisible Man being in this reporter's humble take, the most complex and variegated portrayal of archetypal Black masculinities at war in the muck of American race politics that our serious literature has yet produced. Kendrick Lamar's Good Kid, Mad City, and To Pimp a Butterfly may already be being studied as modern sonic fictions that speak to Ellison's ongoing existentialist omnipresence in our most contemporary of musical paraliteratures. But about Ellison's take on blues people, I agree with Larry Neal, who said Ellison's review of blues people basically just sounded like notes projected towards the blues book Ellison should have written himself and never did. Could be Ellison's partner in crime, Albert Murray, performed that duty for the intellectual tandem when he wrote his expository classics, The Hero in the Blues and Stompin' the Blues. I'll grant that far as it goes. But let's be real, given Ellison's own eloquent dropping of blues knowledge in that legendary descriptive passage you quoted, Ralph E. calling out Amiri B., for Black on Blues theorizing seems a reprise of epic name calling between that kettle and that pot. It's also worth noting the classic It's also worth noting that the classic and oddly edible battle royale quality of Ellison the Emperor going after Baraka, the younger's first blues child baby. All loud out there on the world stage. It's also worth noting the classic and oddly edible battle royale quality of Ellison the Emperor going after Baraka, the younger's first blues child baby. All loud out there on the world stage, and just as Baraka's own white hot star was rising in the New York literary and theater world. For his part, Baraka never said much else about Ellison beyond what he dropped in his 1965 essay, Leroy Jones Talking. For his part, Baraka never said much else about Ellison beyond what he dropped in his 1965 essay, Leroy Jones Talking, where he considered Ellison's fate in American letters as a cautionary tale, that of a black man isolated and enshrined in the lily-white academy, unable to generate more significant writing. A model to Baraka for the kind of caged bird he didn't want to end up being. All that aside, though, let's deal with specifics re Ellison's criticisms of blues people. In a nutshell, I'd say we find in that review one of the more wrathful misreadings of one brilliant writer by another ever put to pen. First off, if Ellison had really had an issue with class analysis and even Marxist class condemnation of the bourgeoisie as a feature of black cultural observation, he would never have given us the gut-wrenching, class-drenched contrast between his Bledsoe and True Blood characters in Invisible Man, or never depicted his nameless, hapless, and deeply alienated Joe College protagonist blues as those of one seriously miseducated, class mobility distressed Negro, one revealed in his Pilgrim's Awkward Progress as frighteningly estranged from working class 1930s and 40s, hard scuffle, hipster-graced Harlem. So let's take a minute here and talk about what's really going on in Blues People as a sui generis work of self-confessedly theoretical speculations on the history of black music in America from slavery to the then-now of 1964. The yester-now, you dig, per Miles Davis's coinage. Blues People also speaks through a glass darkly to a 1964 framed by Castro's march into Havana and MLK's dreamy march on Washington and Birmingham and Selma at that. For those of us who teach black American music survey courses, there are but two Bibles, Baraka's Blues People and Elaine Southern's historical masterpiece, The Music of Black Americans. There's no finer musicological scholarship on the subject than Sister Southern's, as there's no richer body of philosophical inquiry than Blues People, a book which digs deep into how a cultural revolution sprang from enslaved, Holy Ghost-catching, Hush Harbor convocations, the Monk Deers and Birds, musical Manhattan Project down in Minton's Playhouse, which then turned Harper's spatial by the mid-60s via such trans-bluesing eruptions as Ornette Coleman's Shape of Jazz to Come, John Coltrane's The Love Supreme, Cecil Taylor's Unit Structures, Albert Ayler's Spiritual Unity, and Sun Ra's Heliocentric World. All that said, however, here's the real catch, one which totally unthreads Ralph E's whole attack on the blues, according to Miri B. Ellison and Baraka actually don't even disagree, oddly enough, on the very Americanness of this miracle we call black music today. Because indeed, one of the core cornerstone pursuits of the blues people, emphatically repeated in the book's early chapters,
is identifying at what point and by what means did the enslaved African of yore become the Americanized black of Yan and Yoshun. The globe-tripping creators of all those blues, jazz, soul, funk, hip-hop, house people who can't stop performing the supreme Africanization and syncretization of Western music in their own insurgent, hoodoo-hollering, Black Atlantic, bebop, ghost-spiced, new African dark matter vernaculars. To you, sir.
I hear you, fellow GT. Thee of the cultural nationalist neo-hoodoo, sci-fi, quantum physics-inspired, cosmic political riffs of thine own idiosyncrasy. I feel you too, stylizing your conception of a black aesthetic reflecting the layered motifs and motives of a black Atlantic frame in the time and space of a North American imagination. However, my stream of consciousness, brother, let's go deeper for a moment into the divergence between Ellison and Baraka's views on the blues and the abstract truth, or the blues and the gut pucker truth. Once agreeing to disagree, then let's venture into the fruitful arena of sweet convergence you reference with a relish of irony at the close of your first letter. If we bracket the similarities between Ellison and Baraka and their conceptions of the cultural and national origins of blues and jazz, we can better pursue their distinctions. Perhaps Perhaps we'll end with a result, a unified whole that will clarify how both are relevant today. Like going from, say, Freddie Hubbard's swinging waltz, Up Jump Spring, to Rapper's Delight, Up Jump the Rhythm of the Boogity Beat. So, I don't think that Ellison's review of Blues People is one of the more wrathful misreadings of one brilliant writer by another brilliant writer ever put to pen. Rather, it's a rap on the knuckles from a master to a promising journeyman. As when Grandmaster of Jazz Drums Papa Joe Jones took his sticks and pow, hit the middle of a very young Grady Tate's hand and said, "That's so you know some of the pain you're going to experience if you're going to be a drummer in this music." Like the time Sonny Rollins invited Branford Marsalis to play with him at Carnegie Hall and ritually massacred him so Branford could be reborn into a better player. Or take Jordan versus Kobe in Kobe's first season in the NBA. You think Jordan took it easy on Kobe? Nah. I will say, though, that I wish Ellison would have been more open to mentor Baraka as Jordan was to Kobe. But the point is this. We are talking about what Ellison and Murray, via Joseph Campbell, by way of Heinrich Zimmer, called antagonistic cooperation, opposition that cooperates with you to make you better, stronger, more ready to live in the mold and mode of the heroic mindset of champions. Bro, are we talking about an initiation ritual? Ellison was publicly sparring with Baraka and actually did so in a sparing way. He wasn't really trying to devastate Baraka as if Baraka threatened him. The fact that Ellison engaged with him at all was a sign of respect, which is why early on in the review he says, Jones would take his subject seriously as the best jazz critics have always done, and he himself should be so taken. And later, read as the record of an earnest young man's attempt to come to grips with his predicament as Negro American during a most turbulent period of our history, Blues People may be worth people's time. Jones had to know that once he put out a book on the blues, that not only what Ellison once called a little man from Cheehaw Station might come out from the Blue Train woodshed, but that an acknowledged literary master might too. Considering the authority and magnitude of Ellison's critical armament, as for instance displayed in his Muhammad Ali float like a butterfly, sting like a bee takedown of Irving Howe in the essay, The World and the Jug, you know good and well he took it easy on your man. In my first letter, I got a kick out of Ellison's signifying statements and the way he punctures assumptions, but the more pregnant point is the danger of fitting a complex, pluralistic, and vernacular cultural dynamic into cardboard types based on class and race, when the reality of our actual history and lives, both male and female, have been more diverse in motivation, attitude, and action than largely shown in Blues People. Ellison and Murray both believe that, one, we have been a part of the so-called mainstream of American culture from even before we became enslaved here, and that two, we have to accurately define ourselves in order to best create the America as we envision it to be in terms of destiny. But as you say, Blues People, along with Eileen Southern's The Music of Black Americans, is a canonic text taught to young people studying our musical legacy in the academy. That's why it's so very important to note the flaws as well as what you perceive as the glories of Baraka's work, one of the reasons you became a writer in the first place. I'd add Stompin' the Blues by Murray, the Bob O'Mealy edited collection of Ellison's writing, Living with Music, and Samuel Freud Jr.'s The Power of Black Music to the canon. This way, students can get a granular grasp of what Russian philosopher Mikhail Bakhtin called a dialogic discourse, and what Kenneth Burke, a favorite of Ellison and Murray's, called statement counterstatement, the way artists and intellectuals comment, directly or indirectly, on each other's work, like jazz musicians trading fours and eights, but in print, or like we today are doing here on stage. Now, to your points about Ellison's use of class analysis via characters and Invisible Man, sure, that's true, so to speak. Barbara Foley, author of Wrestling with the Left, The Making of Ralph Ellison's Invisible Man, would likely co-sign your point of view. But as a work of fiction with rounded characters derived from the cultural and historical trajectory of our people and this nation, Invisible Man can't and shouldn't be reduced to a social realist document for approval by left-wing Marxists. If Baraka had ears to hear Ellison's critique, maybe he wouldn't have gone off the ideological deep ends of black nationalism and Marxism through Mao and would have maintained his incredible promise as a literary man rather than becoming an agitprop man. In my next letter, I'll get to his statement about Ellison as a so-called black man so isolated and enshrined in the Lily White Academy and unable to generate significant writing. But I'll close this one by saying that Baraka didn't have to say much about Ellison himself, since his followers and comrades in the Black Arts Movement took pot shots at Ellison and others of an older generation. Truly a shameful Oedipal situation. I'm aware that as a social movement becomes more radicalized, that nuance, subtlety, and scholarly analysis can give way to propaganda, rhetorical excess, or friendly fire, and even to homophobia and anti-Semitism. But now that we can view those days with the clarity of hindsight and decades of scholarship hints, there's no need to be sentimental about the Black Arts Movement. I contend that the Black Arts Movement has a mixed legacy. You quoted Baraka's Black Arts Movement partner, Larry Neal, as saying that Ellison's review was like notes towards the book he should have written. Yet in Neal's essay, Ellison's Zoot Suit, he actually came to terms with Ellison. And then he proceeded to introduce Stanley Crouch, Plaithell Benjamin, and Professor Henry Louis Gates Jr. to Albert Murray's work. Neal perceived Ellison as one of his literary fathers. Ellison's certainly one of mine. To you, sir.
As Ishmael Reed likes to say, bro, GT, writing is fighting. The history and black letters of our best and brightest scrapping and performing constructive takedowns of one another in print is long, epic, and at times even butt ugly. Richard Wright's slam of persons their eyes were watching God may actually be the most wrathful attack an established black writer has made on an emergent one. Hurston is having the last laugh, no doubt. But can't forget Baldwin famously hammered Wright in his essay, Everybody's Protest Novel. And Ellison famously said of his early mentor Wright that Wright's major flaw was an inability to create a character as intelligent as himself. Reading Ish Reed's obsessive hypermasculine assaults on Alice Walker is nearly as appalling as reading Wright on Hurston. Stanley Crouch will tell you that all he wanted to do when he first started writing was to sound like Leroy Jones. But his ire for Baraka's writing beyond 1967 achieves a fever pitch of antipathy matched only by Crouch's utter disdain for the electronic Miles Davis, who Stanley once likened to a trumpeting winged death head. That said, you'd be hard-pressed to find any hard prose evidence of the major writers of the Black Arts Movement taking pot shots at Ellison. And considering how much open disdain Ellison expressed for what other black novelists has achieved relative to himself, that's pretty remarkable. As modern black writers on culture and politics, Ellison is certainly one of our godfathers, but then so is Langston Hughes, who befriended Ellison early after his New York arrival. Hughes' generosity of spirit towards younger black writers spanned generations. He graciously sent Baraka a congratulation letter upon publication of his preface to a 20-volume suicide note. But Baraka and Baldwin both reigned on Hughes in Oedipal fashion when they were young Turks on the literary come-up. All that said, I've got to take exception to your characterizing Baraka's writing on our music and the black middle class as cardboard and reductive. Its analysis of black internecine class conflict is far more complex and nuanced in reasoning and historicizing than that. Check the record. This is Leroy Jones talking in Blues People. Quote, nowhere else in the United States is the French influence more apparent than in New Orleans. It was this predominantly French culture that set the tone for the Europeanization of African slaves in the area. The mulattoes, or light-skinned slaves, were the result, usually, of some less than legal union between the French masters and black slave women. They even adopted the name Creole to distinguish themselves from other Negroes. The exotic quadrilles of the French marching bands, 2-4, and 6-8, and the military marching bands also made a great impression on the Creoles, and they tried to incorporate those elements of French culture completely, learning the quadrilles by rote. By 1894, there was a legislative act enforcing segregation, which hit the black Creoles hardest. It also, in the long run, helped redirect their social and musical energies. Up until the time of the infamous discriminative codes, the Creoles enjoyed an autonomy of social and economic status. To a certain extent, they had the same economic and social advantages as the whites. Many of them also sent their children to France to be educated, where many remained. Quite a few Creoles were among the richest family in New Orleans, and others were well-known artisans and craftsmen. But with the segregation acts of the 19th century, many Creoles began to lose the jobs where they were working with whites and were no longer permitted to play. It was about this same time that the darker
darker blues-oriented musicians from uptown New Orleans were beginning to play their dirty instrumental music in saloons and dance halls. The timbres and tones that people like Buddy Bolden began to use were radically removed from the pure sonorities of European-style marching bands. There was a much more vocal playing. Again, this seems part of the definable cycle in the response of the Negro to the cultural and social stimuli of the country. The Negro developing out of what seemed like imitations of European music into a form and content that was relatively autonomous. Primitive blues is a much more Negro music than much of the music it grew out of. End quote, drop the mic, MC Amiri Baraka was here and has now left the building. So end of the day, G, Ellison just wrote a review on those musicological scriptures about how the blues was born, but Baraka wrote the book, if not the Unholy Devil's Music Bible. And if that's giving the blues, then I say the blues are better off of being beneficiaries of a Baraka-fied literary beatdown. Same as Michael Jordan was after Allen Iverson put the Warp Drive crossover dribble on him when he hit that all-net jumper in Philly on March 12, 1997. As always in our combative culture, the torch got passed on the battlefield that night. Ditto occurred upon the publication of Baraka's Blues People in 1964.
GT2, probably right. In my defense of Ellison from people on the left who attacked him after Invisible Man was published, including black folk in Harlem who criticized him for turning down panel invitations, I think I conflated those jokers with the Black Arts Movement. Though, Hoyt Full of the Black World, a chronicler of the Black Arts Movement, certainly took issue with Ellison vociferously. If so, my bad. But dig this. In your defense of your forebear, you ain't even mentioned the very book by Baraka that got you rolling, Black Music. Published in 1967, a few years after Blues People, Black Music was an influential chronicle on the new experimental music scene that came to be called avant-garde and free jazz. So you may want to amend your analogy a bit. Maybe Blues People should be called your Old Testament and Black Music, the New Testament, you dig? Now, of course, if that was the case, Stanley Cross might say that might be reason to become an atheist. But let's put this in perspective. In the same way that the stance is taken by Frederick Douglass and Martin Delaney, W.E.B. Du Bois and Booker T. Washington, and Dr. King and Malcolm X form contrasting historical models for the advancement of our people, as does the pioneering legacies of legendary women such as Anna Julia Cooper, Ida B. Wells, Zora Neale Hurston, Mary Lou Williams, Ella Baker, and Sylvia Winter. The divergences between Ralph Ellison and Amiri Baraka in our post-civil rights movement, post-industrial, post-modern, late capitalism times can be instructive. From one perspective, maybe an Afro-pessimist one, both Ralph E. and Amiri B. could be viewed in tragic terms. In the case of Ellison, not completing and releasing his second novel in his lifetime can be considered tragic. And though Baraka was prolific, writer's block was not an issue. He allowed changing ideological and beliefs to mar, in my estimation, the quality and potential displayed in his early works. But on the other hand, Amiri B.'s influence on our very discussion today and on American letters since the 1960s hasn't solely been about the quality of his early scholarship and how he depicted black folks and blues and musicians and blues people and black music. It's also been in the way he loosened up our syntax and writing and closed the gap between black oral and literary expression through what became known as spoken word poetry but set to music. And as you wrote in your courageous 1984 review in the Village Voice of your mentor's memoir, yo, homeboy, homegirl, you can talk that arty talk and walk that walk, slide in your stride, zip in your hip, so go on ahead with your bad self. Mix that intellectual shit in with a few healthy doses of yang and you'll still be cool. End quote. So Baraka's legacy isn't just tragic, and his oh-so-American trait of remaking himself in various political and ideological guises can even be viewed as comic to the point of farce. And neither, in my view, is Ellison's literary legacy tragic. Not at all. Ellison, for me, along with Albert Murray, cleared away a fog left in the wake of the civil rights and black arts movement and the backlash to both as regards a moral and political imperative to hold on to the pragmatic and prophetic ideals of black American culture and the American values of equality as fairness and democracy as a verb, as praxis, so that we can continue, slowly but surely, as a people and a nation, to move toward their fulfillment. The latter was, recall, a message of Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King and James Baldwin's too. I could care less if Ellison didn't publish a second novel in his lifetime. What was published, first in excerpt form as Juneteenth in 1999 and then unexpurgated in 2010 as 3 days before the shooting, contains passages, according to Stanley Crouch, that rival the best he's ever written. But 3 days before the shooting never cohered as a narrative. He couldn't find a way to make that happen. Those 1,000-plus pages also show that he didn't have writer's block. Neither do I think it had anything to do with being disconnected from the black community or being ensconced in the so-called white academy. Whatever the reason or reasons he couldn't make it work for publications, these speculations are a distraction from dealing with the totality of what Ellison did write. The essays, the speeches, as well as the interviews as ritual encounter with the master, and the lyrical wisdom we can squeeze from them. For instance, Lehigh University scholar James Braxton Peterson, in his recently published book, The Hip-Hop Underground and African-American Culture, uses Ellison's iconic opening scenes as a touchstone. Remember the nameless protagonist underground smoking weed with 1,369 light bulbs overhead listening to Louis Armstrong sing What Did I Do to Be So Black and Blue on multiple turntables at the same time? Peterson directly ties Ellison to hip-hop praxis. Michigan State University professor of English James Seaton calls Ellison a poet of democratic excellence. Afrofuturist scholars point to Baraka and Ishmael Reed as primary influences and recognize that Ellison's way of dealing with time, technology, and sonic soul in Invisible Man marks it as a clear proto-Afrofuturist text. Scholar Timothy Parrish considers Ellison a political theorist and civic statesman. As Parrish writes in his excellent book, Ralph Ellison and the Genius of America, quote, recently, beyond the lines policed by departments of English and African American studies, scholars from a variety of disciplines have worked to specify the breadth of Ellison's influence as an intellectual intent on changing the course of American society. Historians, Leon Litwack, legal scholars, Richard Kluger, and political scientists, Harvard's own Danielle Allen, have argued that Ellison is essential to understanding, respectively, post-Civil War American history, the role of Brown v. Board of Education in American society, and the Civil Rights Movement and its ongoing aftermath. None of these scholars sees Ellison as a failed novelist or questionable representative of black identity, end quote. Of course, my mellow fellow GT, to your credit, neither have you questioned the value of Ellison's work and legacy. One of the key reasons I wanted us to have this exchange is because, as you outlined in your last letter, there have been a plethora of literary switchblade fights among our major lights. But you and me, we cool, always been. Perhaps our civil discourse can serve to bridge some divides, heal some wounds, point a way to swing our discourse without playing rhetorical dozens so hot and heavy, as in a recent New Republic cover story, that issues get bound up with personal egos and those axes that so many of our predecessors incessantly grind. This is the spirit of civility, bridging, and healing that I get from a sister scholar I greatly admire, Farrah Jasmine Griffin, an English comp lit and African American studies professor at Columbia who graduated from this very institution. To me, she's like Ellison's Mary Rambo character in Invisible Man, but with a PhD, you dig? You all remember Mary Rambo, right? She's the great mother character in Invisible Man who saw the nameless protagonist in the streets of Harlem all disoriented and sick, and who took care of him, tended to him, giving him warm soup, a bed, and a roof under which he could lay down his weary head. Mary supported his aspirations to become an educator while pointing to the need for leadership, saying prophetically, it's you young folks what's gonna make the changes.
Y'all's the ones. You gotta lead, you gotta fight. Move us all on up a little higher.
I tell you something else. It's the ones from the South that's got to do it. Them what knows the fire and ain't forgot how it burns. Up here, too many forgets.
They finds a place for themselves, forget the ones on the bottom. Oh, heaps of them talks about doing things. But they done really forgot.
No, it's you young ones what's got to remember and take the lead. Professor Griffin's mind is keen and her scholarship excellent. Check out the closing chapter of her first book, Who Set You Flowing? The African-American Migration Narrative, for a brilliant exposition on Toni Morrison's novel, Jazz. But I'm talking about that Mary Rambo spirit. During the PBS American Masters documentary on Ellison by Avon Kirkland, Farrah summed up Ellison's work by saying that what comes through is Ellison's love of black people. So true. When I interviewed her for a National Jazz Museum in Harlem conversation series, it wasn't only her profound grasp of our historical, literary, and cultural traditions that got to me. What did was that she didn't pick and choose favorites among our icons. While not forfeiting her critical sense, she still embraced them all as family. And when I mentioned to her that you and I were going to write letters to one another, about Ralph E. and Mary B. and share them publicly, Farrah said, "We're all their literary children anyway. That's what we need," as Mahalia Jackson said, "to move on up a little higher." So in that spirit, and considering our limited time, Brad Tate, can you share with the peoples how Ellison and Amiri converge and point to the way to why, for black folks, our music is the good, the true, and the beautiful, but in about 500 words?
Did you really just say that? Want me to sum up the crossroads of Ralphie and Amiri B in 500 words or less, dude?
Aye, make it 700. Dude, make it 700.
So it took a brother nearly 4,000 pithy words just to chronicle Baraka's journey for Ebony.com when he made his transition. But in the interest of brevity, I'll accept the challenge and just say that, as is the case with MLK and Malcolm, I can only look back in wonder and amazement at how blessed we the people were to have two genius word warriors for our literary and musical cultures operating so potently in the 50s, 60s, 70s, and beyond. And they had them both labor so vigorously on behalf of the blues, the very polyrhythmic soil and polyvocal seedbed of our cultural confidence, difference, defiance, and spirit dance. And that was perhaps the greatest love cry that they shared between them of all, especially at a time when many upwardly mobilized black folks were trying to forget the blues in pursuit of partial integration. Because decades before it became the hot slogan of the day, Ellison and Baraka were openly declaring that black lives mattered and that the music produced by black lives could transform the world and change matter in something in the way of things, especially in the way of things Baraka and Canton and meditated upon, re our folks' familial intimacy with death, in his 2002 collaboration with The Roots on the Phrenology album. Ellison and Baraka also picked up the challenge laid to them by Frederick Douglass and W.E.B. Du Bois, immediate predecessors, who early on recognized the power of black music to speak to those higher truths being broadcast from the culture's lower depths on a daily basis. Ellison, of course, also performed the necessary math on Du Bois' notion of double consciousness and discovered the core themes of black life and letters, invisibility and fugitivity, as conditioned and as militarily intelligent tactics. Baraka, of course, brought in the final computations needed to break the veil of double consciousness and ivory tower invisibility by throwing his lyrical theatrical jihad of a poetic voice out on Front Street on behalf of the dark and voiceless. You could even say Baraka's own life narrative reads like an invisible man pilgrimage in reverse. All those slick, sudden moves from cosmopolitan quick change artists to hardcore Marxist, Maoist, Leninist to community ensconced Newark nativist who sees his son Ross, named after Ellison's Ross the Destroyer, now surviving him as the city's of his birthplace's current mayor. More on that later in the Q&A if anyone's vaguely interested. Ellison and Baraka implored, insisted, and cajoled other middle-class black folk to not believe the hype that sold us a fool's gold, belief that by becoming assimilated materialistic American consumers, we'd really discover the road to real equality. Because of E and B's unconditional love for jazz and blues, they recognized that black folk music had the capacity to elevate the expressive character of America, to bring the country closer to realizing its democratic ideals. And because they put all that in between the cover of book, they dared risk their tuneful truths held to be self-evident might never be found by other Negroes. You know, as per that old signifying adage, if you want to hide something from the Negro, put it in a book. My dearly beloved, dearly departed Mama Tate used to slip that one in whenever the folk turned up missing information that could only be gleaned by hitting the stacks. She also liked to affirm her membership in the elite circle of dedicated black readers by unequivocally and sarcastically declaring There's 50 black people in the world who know how to read and write, and we all know each other. That number may have expanded on Facebook, but I know for damn sure my 50 better have read Invisible Man and at least heard of Baraka, if not heard one of his many Jeremiahs bent on chasing out the twin devils of capitalism and white supremacy. So, viva la word magicians and alphabetical conjurers, Ralph Ellison and Amiri Baraka. All right. Thank you. What's up? Yes.
Hello.
Hey.
So, you know, we can't end this conversation without talking about what Kendrick Lamar did last night at the Grammys.
And what Beyonce did at the Super Bowl.
And all that good stuff. You know what I'm saying? So I'm curious to hear about how do we fit their performances of black protests and black aesthetics within this capitalistic structure and this deemed post-racial post everything, insert post whatever you want to hear moment in American history. What are your thoughts on how they fit into this trajectory of black protest aesthetics that have been presented by both Ellison and Baraka?
Okay. Well, my friend Vernon Reed likes to say, au contraire, this is not a post-racial era, it's a most racial era, you know. And so we've seen this kind of slow run up since Trayvon Martin's killing and Vincent Ferguson in Baltimore. Black artists doing what they have done within the cycle of response, the historical cycles of response to conditions in the street, which is find their voice, find a language, find a text and a form to actually speak. To the fervor, the fervent rebellion of the grassroots, you know, but to do it in a way that is not simply reductive agitprop that comes from a very strong emotive place, you know, that has the constituent qualities of emotion and new form making that we've come to expect. You know, I'd say going all the way back to Burt Williams, you know, going back to Scott Joplin, you know, Tremonisha. So when I looked at both of those performances, what I actually see is artists who are very focused, concentrated, tight in terms of their delivery in the recording studio. And know how to use that platform with state-of-the-art facility and urgency to deliver the sonic response, but then are also addressing this particular moment and this particular demand on the most potent of the artists to respond in kind with spectacle, you know, to respond with theatrical, operatic pageantry, you know, and razzle-dazzle, as it were. You know what I mean? To use that platform they have in a way that simulates the fire that's happening this time, you know? So I was struck, you know, I was telling Greg, I said, you know, I think one of the things the moment I was most struck by in Kendrick's performance was when they actually flashed on the audience. And not only were people in shock, but there was so much fire literally coming from the pyrotechnics. Everybody in the audience looked like they had got an instant suntan. You know what I mean? Like, that's how infernal the blaze was coming from the stage. You know, so that really speaks to, him going all in and using to the limits of his imagination and the technical and fire code capacity of that theater. You know, all the devices that were going to make his statement not just observed and seen, but felt, and even potentially dangerous to the house, you know, the house that Grammy's built, you know. It was like, he came, I mean, he kind of literally came to burn that house down, you know. And, you know, and it was interesting just thinking about To Pimp a Butterfly, Good Kid, Mad City, in an analogous way to Thriller and Off the Wall with Michael Jackson, because Michael was snubbed when he released Off the Wall, and he was so pissed off by that, you know, that's why he decided, okay, I'm gonna make this epic you can't deny, you know. And and in some ways, you know, the earlier album, I think is the one that speaks most poignantly to his internal sense of drama. But this one is the one, it's a full-scale guerrilla assault, you know, on everything, you know. So I'll stop there, yeah.
Go ahead. So I'm gonna take the blues and jazz side of your question, but I will just comment on, I think there's a distinction between Kendrick and Beyonce. I think that Kendrick's at a much earlier stage of his career. I think that Beyonce, it's very complex because, I mean, Beyonce is arguably the number one pop star in the world. That's arguable, but I think it's true. And so she's using her fame, her market power, to project certain images that align with the moment and align with the movement at this moment. But doing it in a way at the same time where she's fully exploiting, you know, her beauty, her femininity, and it's so complex that, you know, some people are like, you know, is she exploiting Louisiana? Is she exploiting the Black Panthers? You know, and, is she representing it properly? I mean, these are very complex questions, but, you know, actually in her position, she doesn't have to connect with that at all if she didn't want to. She has that kind of power. So the fact that she does, I think, is a statement in and of itself, aside from the complexities. Kendrick Lamar, what I want to focus on to answer your question on the connection to blues and jazz is the dynamic in jazz is a synthesis, is a fusion of elements. So fundamentally, we could say that jazz has African elements, has Latin American elements, has European elements. Okay. What I saw last night with Kendrick Lamar was, musically, was an incredible amalgam of styles. I mean, obviously the hip hop was there, but I heard rock, Caribbean, jazz, African, like within 2 minutes. It was an incredible display of musical diversity. So the connection to the political is this. We have learned that to deal with this monster, there's no one particular road or approach or ideology that's going to do it. We're going to have to, you know, be like the musicians and be shameless about taking what works over here, taking what works over there. If this works, that doesn't work, we let it go. It's not about the ideology. It's about what works, and that gets to pragmatism. You know, so I think we can learn from our history and the music in such a way that we are open to embracing what works in particular context. And it's the context. If the context changes, a particular strategy or tactic may not work in a particular situation. And it's another situation it might. So that's what I would say the connection directly to blues and jazz is in terms of how we strategize politically. Okay? You're welcome. Okay. Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. I wasn't here for all the presentation, but I've been wondering about the issue of mainstreaming of hip-hop and other African-American-informed genre, musical genres, mm-hmm. and especially about Hamilton, which is now the biggest thing ever, you know, people mm-hmm. are ripping off for tickets, you know, people being cheated. So I wonder if you could speak to that, to what does this represent when you have such really successful mainstreaming of African-American culture by you know, in a very public and very successful medium in the big, on the biggest stage, you know, in America. How does this?
That's as American as apple pie. That's the American way. In a capitalist system, to use and exploit commodities and culture, you know, to make money. But what happens with people who, and I don't like to use minority, I don't like subaltern, I don't like certain expressions. But what happens is, in the same way that with language, I taught in junior high school in the late 90s, and this is something that, you know how when you're younger, you just are in the midst of your own culture, but you can't step back and analyze it. It was when I was working with junior high school students that I witnessed what has been the case with Black American cultures in terms of linguistics and language from Lord knows how long. I saw how when the mainstream culture adopts a particular lingo, puts it on a commercial, the young people say, okay, now we got to go to something else. We got to create something else. So the reason I bring up that example is because in the same way, that's what happens in the culture. So a particular form or style gets commercialized. You have some people who, of course, will try to exploit that and go and imitate that so they can become successful. But then you also have counter movements, counter statements, counter approaches to say, you know, we're going to go another direction. You have regional dynamics that functions on. So you're talking about different types of hip hop, different types of jazz, blues, and styles, just regionally in response to what is being promoted as the thing. And these days, when the radio industry has been so consolidated, when the record industry has been consolidated, and the influence of the internet, you have, you know, movements that you may not hear about, but they're there. So I just want to focus on the counter responses. But I mean, in terms of them exploiting culture, I mean, that's just, I mean, our culture in particular, but period.
I didn't use the term exploiting because what I see is in the, I said mainstreaming.
When I say exploiting, I don't necessarily mean it with a negative connotation.
Okay.
I mean, exploit usually has a negative connotation. I mean it in a business sense.
Okay.
When you exploit something in a business sense, that's neutral. You use it. I didn't really mean it in a negative connotation. But I want to make sure Greg has a chance to.
I mean, historically we know Black culture is irresistible globally. You know, it's like everybody wants a taste of it. Everybody wants a piece of it. And it's constantly regenerating itself once any reflection of it becomes subject to cliche, derivation, to being distilled, you know, by the consumer market, you know. I mean, but the thing is that it also it's also reflective of the fact that Black culture is obsessed with modernity. Musically, it's obsessed with technology. We're also obsessed, I would say, from the performer side, with reaching the widest possible audience, you know, for the work and creating the most epic, spectacular platforms for it, you know, so that somebody like a Robert Johnson, whose kind of historic image is of this guy in a room with his slide guitar, you know, one mic in the room recording his 30 songs. But his vision, we know from people who work with him, like Johnny Shines, was he wanted to have a big band like Basie. So it's like all that music, Crossroads Blues, Terraplane Blues, 3220, you know, he heard all of that with horns, you know, and you know, driving drums, the whole thing. It's like basically what we're hearing, we're in the demos, you know, for what he wanted to do. And I mean, hip hop lets you know at the birth that, you know, what it's most concerned with is figuring out how to live larger, you know, to get to that place in the center of the arena. You know what I mean? And so what we've been graced with over the last 30 years is watching the ways in which the artists have not only grip the most advanced technical apparatus, but then grip the access of distribution and marketing and promotion and presentation, you know. So, you know, and you, I mean, the culture is just always, it's always fighting to get in somewhere in America. So, I mean, Hamilton represents, you know, when I looked at that performance on the Grammys, you know, as anybody who's ever been to Broadway knows, it's like, yeah, those moments when black people in mass have a presence there are rare, you know. So, you know, but I also thought this too, you know what I mean? Because one of the things that's, how do I want to put this? Yeah, I say questionable about the text of that piece is it really eschews any condemnation of these founders for their connection to slavery.
The introduction, the first song that they
had? No, I mean the show in itself.
Oh.
You know what I mean? It's like, I mean, he's talked about how it's deliberately focused on what he wanted to deal with in terms of Hamilton economics, so forth, and we could argue that's probably why it's a success on Broadway that it is with that particular audience, you know, that core audience, which is, you know, very culturally conservative, you know, before you even get to the political aspects of it. But I thought that, you know, somebody on the curatorial team of the Grammys was on their job, you know, just in terms of following that with Kendrick's performances, you know, because it was like, okay, here's Hamilton. It's doing its thing with, you know, these lofty debates around what the economy and the politics of the nation is going to be. And here's Kendrick, and like, here's the hell that the slave owning founders built, you know. So it was a beautiful kind of byplay that happened there on the Grammy stage last night.
You brought us a very exciting and insightful exchange, and you should be complimented for it. I wondered, sitting here, if you thought about other pairings, and what occurred to me, the James Baldwin-Richard Wright exchange.
Well, we probably had to get Ta-Nehisi Coates to, you know, to be one of the participants in that, but he could do both of those. He could do both Baldwin and Wright, since he's coming out of both of them. I think that's a good idea. You could do Ellison and Wright. You could do, you know, but 2014, and thank you so much for your introduction again, where it was the 50th anniversary of Blues People and the 100th anniversary of, well, 2013 was the 100th anniversary of Ellison's birth, but Baraka passed in 2014, right?
I believe so, yeah.
Yeah. So what happened, let me go a little more detail with how this actually occurred. Social media is a part of it. We've been friends a long time, but Facebook friends. There was an exchange after Baraka passed. There happened to be an Ellison exhibit at the National Jazz Museum in Harlem. And there was this piece that was written in the New Yorker entitled, "Why Did Ralph Ellison Hate Modern Jazz?" And he was talking about actually avant-garde in, you know, the 60s, free jazz. And so one of the points that G. Tate made on Facebook was that Ellison's musical critical ability paled in comparison to incredible imagination and capturing of that on pen, fiction-wise. So he and I were going back and forth, and we were getting into it, collegially, but we were getting into it. And then after a while, we said, why are we putting all this content on Facebook? Let's take this on the road, you know? So this is actually the third time we've done this, you know? So thank you for your comments. Okay. The next. Can you come over so people can see and so Greg can see you? And say who you are.
I'm Dale Gadsden. And in terms of pairings, I will remind you that at one point, Cornel West paired James Baldwin and Lorraine Hansberry. and that was an incredible, powerful pairing. But in terms of today, I'm interested in going back to both Beyonce and Kendrick Lamar's performance and the way in which they brought black bodies into the mainstream in terms of historical, sort of embodying historical protests. And how does that sort of fit with what Amiri Baraka and and Ellison's whole idea about blackness, loving blackness, showing blackness? They did it, of course, in different forms, in a different form, but also just bringing that black body out in public so that we see, because what we've been seeing lately has been black bodies being shot, people protesting the streets, people crying in the streets, but we haven't seen that kind of, let's remember that we had the Black Panthers, and some of them are still here and still out there, and let's remind ourselves that slavery is not over, has never been over, and America has never said unequivocally it will not happen again. So how do you connect that to both Baraka?
Okay, basically the question is Ellison and Baraka in relation to protest as
black physical bodies.
Black physical bodies.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, one of the things that the Black Arts Movement did was that it created a whole form of theater as ritual protest, as ritual response, you know. So you looked at some of the works that Baraka was developing around 67, 68, Spirit House Movers like Black Mass. I mean, there was no way you could even think about them in the terms of a traditional three-act play. Like, they were immersive experiences from the moment you walked in the theater, and sometimes Sunrise Orchestra was providing the music, which was already so that made it a doubly immersive experience. You know, it was like there was never a fourth wall, you know. And I think Baraka, in his art and his practice, his politics, was always trying to shatter the distance between how he was perceived as a writer and how he acted as an activist. You know, I mean, how he organized. You know, and he became, you know, a very powerful, self-dramatizing figure in terms of the movement. Some of you may know there was in 1972, there was a great black political convention in Gary, Indiana, home of Michael Jackson, interestingly enough, you know, and so everybody was there from all contingents. You know, the Nationalists were there, the Panthers were there, you know, SNCC, NAACP, people there, and there were delegates from every state of the Union. So this was a huge event. And so at one point, you know, my mother told me this, they were trying to reach a consensus on a point. And some delegates from New York kind of rose up and were kind of pitching a fit. And my mother said she never forgot. Baraka just turned and said, "In New York, you need to sit down." You know, and that was that. You know what I mean? So he had actually, you know, I mean, and this is what happened in, you know, what some call a leadership vacuum, others would call a transition. From Martin Luther King, Civil Rights Movement, Malcolm X, you know, those losses. So the Black Panthers generate on that soil, and the Black Arts Movement, you know, here in, you know, on the East Coast, is creating, because Baraka is coming, you know, into activism as a poet, you know, as a playwright, as somebody concerned with making magic with the words. You know, I mean, somebody once described him as a word magician, you know. But if you look in the work, he's very much concerned, or he always returns to this use of language from the whole practice of voodoo and spells and conjurings and incantations. And he did an interview before he passed with his daughter Kelly Jones at a Moments PS1. Where they were actually talking about the Black Arts Movement, that legacy. And he said that basically, you know, people who thought that the Black Arts Movement was a proscription for what black art could or couldn't be didn't really hear the double entendre in the way he thought about the phrase. For him, he meant the black arts the way they mean that in relationship to devilish magic, right? You know, and so when you look back in the, you look at the work, you know, I mean, particularly that latter, like, kind of 60s work, you know, I mean, he's constantly invoking this notion of ritual and spells as a thing that in themselves can be powerful enough to kind of destroy everything he hated about America. You know what I mean? So it's actually, so he brought the theatricality, you know, of himself, you know, as a writer into the movement and created forms for the expression of that. And in a lot of ways, I saw Kendrick's performance as an extension of that lineage and those practices in the culture, you know, whether he was conscious of them or not, because with MCs, you never know what they know and they don't know, you know, because they're the best at kind of masking their literacy and their intellect and also their race memory as well.
Just to take off from what Greg was saying and Kendrick Lamar, on one of the songs in To Pimp a Butterfly, he mentions yams in one of the tunes. Huh? Okay. And there's a gentleman named Adam Bradley, who's at the University of Colorado, who graduated from here, who worked with John Callahan on 3 days before the shooting in Juneteenth. And he has a lecture on YouTube where he is exploring whether or not Kendrick Lamar got that whole yam sequence from Invisible Man. And so, but he ends up saying that you just never know. Now, as far as Ellison, I'm going to bring Murray into this also, and protest. People assume that that they were against what they call protest literature because they had the critique of Wright, they had the critique of the literature from the 30s and that type of thing. But then you find Ellison said that, you know, actually all literature, in a sense, is protest. So I just wanted to bring that part out. Now, it's a different generation. Ellison and Murray definitely they're an older generation than the Black Arts Movement. And there are certain things relative to Ellison that he was not going to engage in because he himself had done it in the 30s and 40s. So he saw what happened with the left regarding like Stalinism and that type of thing. He saw what happened with the sloganing. He saw what happened when you take ideology and make it into a be all and end all. One, black folks can get this left out of it. Just you know, this, okay, now we're moving on to another agenda, like in the Brotherhood Invisible Man. But also he wasn't gonna get caught up in being himself someone like on the front lines as a spokesman. See, Baldwin, he adopted the spokesman. He was a spokesman, and God bless him. But neither Ellison nor Murray, though, would be spokesmen. At the same time, you read Trading 12s, their letters from the 50s, and they are both incredibly excited about what was happening with the civil rights movement. It was like Moses on the move. They had all these different names for black folks, Jasper, Mose. And so they definitely supported the movement. You read Murray's The Omni-Americans and his critique. Now, this is a military man. He was a captain. But you read his critique of white folks in there. And the psychological, you know, depth, it's almost frightening because he's like getting all up in it, you know. And he is promoting, and this is key, heroism, which may not be au courant these days, but he's got the hero in the blues, stomping the blues, and his concept of heroism relates to like the revolutionary movement. He said, now listen, this is a military man, so he knows the weaponry, the strategy, all that stuff from a military perspective. And he was not conservative. He was actually radical in his own way. He said, look, you could talk about revolution, but to have a revolution, you sure better have some heroes. You sure better have some people with the courage and the wherewithal and the knowledge to do what it takes to create the strategies and tactics in order to enact. First, as a military, you get an estimate of the situation, right? Then you create a battle plan. I mean, so that's how he thinks. So I would say that they are certainly supportive of protest. What they are wary against is the overuse of ideology, of sloganing, and not critical thinking, not analytical thinking. So they're a bit wary of and they were wary of certain aspects of the Black Arts Movement because of that.
Well, you also don't want to slight Beyonce
in terms of
your response on the point, because it was like I was trying to call up this Facebook post that I made, but basically I said, end of the day, Beyonce gave Black America the victory they wanted to see from Cam Newton and the Panthers. You know, flawless leadership on the field, heroic bringing your team to victory on the field. You know what
Literally
I mean?
Literally and figuratively.
Daring do, you know what I mean? You know, just spectacular presence and execution. Right. You know, and I think I said something about, she observed the first rule of hip-hop according to Rakim, which is ain't no mistakes allowed. You know, and I said there are never any balls dropped or found drooping on Team B, you know. So, I mean, all of that is in play, too. It's like this commitment to your agenda in spite of the situation, the circumstance. Like, you know, I mean, you know, Brothers Young was like, yeah, clearly on Cam Newton's part, like, the situation got in his head. Something in the situation got in his head. You know, you can say it's the NFL. You can say it's performance anxiety, what have you. But
you talking about his reaction after the loss?
Oh no, I ain't even talking about that. I'm talking about on the field. That's all that matters.
Well, that was defense, man. Yeah. That was the defense of the other team.
But I mean, that's what make you know whatever. I'm not even gonna get into that analysis. You know, I'm just saying that as Black spectators sitting there in America, you know, waiting to see our ostensible team win, the team that won was Team B. You know, and to me, I mean, in some ways, like that was such a horrible game to watch. Anyway, that it's like, you know, at this point, you know, she kind of owns Super Bowl 2016, you know, in terms of the theater, in terms of the memory theater of America. That's like, that's all people are going to be talking about, you know, in as people did, you know. But I was also going to say in terms of the, you know, the critique that you found around of her exploiting the Panthers. I was like, man, people forget the Panthers began as a guerrilla theater operation. That was their first act. They didn't go into the state house planning to shoot anybody. You know what I mean? That was a media spectacle. And they were brilliant and crafty in terms of every element of design. Panther uniforms, the whole thing. You know what I mean? 10-point, the manifesto, all of it. I mean, everything about the Panthers was about, in the beginning, was about how to dramatize their movement on the world stage and then extend it into the more meritorious work that we know them for, you know. But I think it's also interesting to look at, you know, what's happening. You know, I mean, because I love the stealth bomber element of Beyonce's steez, you know what I mean? Because, you know, she gets you looking here and then it's like, oh, bam, she's on the Super Bowl. Then you find out, oh, she's done this documentary giving Black men voice to talk about their particular pain and aligning herself, you know, with them. So, I mean, we're seeing this transitional kind of moment and momentum with her in terms of an identification and action through the platform and using the resources she has to reach the mass public, you know. So all of that's in play.
I agree. Yeah. And I think another element, we shouldn't lose this, and this relates to Ellison Murray. Oh, how much time do we have?
We got one more question after this.
Okay. Individual excellence is so important. So that when you look at a Beyonce, I mean, her work ethic, her sense of perfectionism, I mean, people look at flawless performances and look at what, but the same thing when you hear jazz, you hear Charlie Parker, you hear John Coltrane, Sonny Rollins, Clifford Brown, you hear these people, and the virtuosity is just so off the charts that it goes back to the original meaning of virtuosity, you know, virtues, the ethics of it, you know what I mean? So I really think that it's really important to emphasize that as much as we have a group dynamic with movements, that individual excellence is the foundation of it. And that goes back to jazz. If every single person in a group, and this goes to sports too, does their particular role and job to the utmost, and then you collectivize that, that's a very powerful force, you know? So as much as we think in terms of group dynamics, ourselves as a people and such, individual excellence, and this is not individuality in terms of, you know, a liberalism of just individuality with no connection to community. No, no, it's both. But I really wanted to mention that because that's very important to them in particular. Yes.
All right, thank you for your time, appreciate it. But my question was, do you feel that today's hip-hop or literary poets and thinkers have as much political power into actively changing political structures, or do you feel the impact was bigger from, say, the 60s to today's music and politics? And I say, why aren't more conscious creatives pushed as mainstream artists? I guess citing artists such as Gil Scott-Heron, Nina Simone, Noam Chomsky, Bob Dylan. Like, why do you think, that are artists
Noam
today?
Noam Chomsky an artist?
No, not as an artist, but just as a thinker as well. Okay. And kind of like, you know, how back in the 60s, why do you feel like, I guess, they're not as pushed as, I guess, premier artists or mainstream artists today?
Well, I mean, we're looking at that whole notion of their presence and power in the rear view. You know, it's accumulated a certain power in our appreciation of that moment, you know, because it's achieved its own kind of mythic. The moment itself has achieved a mythic status, but because I, you know, was raised in a house, what I call the Church of Black Power, you know, and so, you know, my parents were in the March on Washington. They were part of the African Liberation Movement in the 70s, so they were part of that whole transition. It was a slow grind, you know, and artists kind of moving from the sidelines or moving from just being part of fundraising efforts to actually making volatile vocal statements in their work, you know, that also happened very slowly. You kind of began with, I'd say in the, you know, early, mid-60s with Nina Simone, Curtis Mayfield, were the people who were making, you know, music that was most aligned with the movement. But some of the music that's most reflective.
Marvin Gaye.
Yeah, I mean, but all that, but that's, you know, that's like, Marvin Gaye's in the business like 10 years before he's even thinking about making, you know, a socio-political statement, you know what I mean? And there's a lot of music that's reflective of the energy, the rebelliousness of that moment that really doesn't begin to emerge until the 70s. You know, so you can look at Gamblin' Huff, Philly International, OJ's, you know, For the Love of Money, Backstabbers, I mean, you know, any number of tunes that came. But, you know, all of that is a consequence of artists kind of assimilating, you know, the struggle. And also being able to participate in the platforms that open, you know. There's just certain things that became possible in the 70s, like a Soul Train, that couldn't have happened 2 years before. You know what I mean? It was like the politics, the consciousness, had began to move these superstructures to, you know, kind of break these doors open, you know, and make it possible for Black people to participate on that executive corporate, you know, capitalizing level, you know, with the culture, you know, inside of mass media, you know, unprecedented, you know. So, you know, it was just a slow kind of build up there. So it's like when we think about that era, it's like we're actually compacting and condensing, you know, what really was like a 15-year process, you know. But, I would argue that, you know, in the last 2 years in the music, we're just starting to see people who are kind of began to taking on the responsibility of being an artist in that lineage, you know. And sometimes it's not even directly political. Sometimes it's kind of what people are doing with the form or with their own individualized expression, you know, to not be a cookie cutter artists inside of the industry, you know what I mean? So, and I mean, look, artists are just like everybody else, you know, in the sense that that pressure that kind of builds from a Ferguson radiates outward,
right.
You know. I was talking about my mother, you know, she said, yeah, it was, she she had been, she grew up Memphis, you know, she said high school she came up in every day was Black History Day. She had like amazing teachers, you know, so it's a conscious Black person. But in terms of becoming part of a movement, she said, yeah, it was that the bombing in Birmingham, you know. You know, those four young women, she said that was the pivotal moment. And I've heard that from other people, you know, of her generation, you know. So, I mean, yeah, I mean, sometimes, like, yes, there must be sacrifice and martyrdom and loss of blood, you know, before a mass movement begins to build. And the artists who are most kind of attuned to, you know, have that one ear in the street and the other in that other ether, you know, where the art, you know, kind of gets delivered from, you know, they're going to be the first to kind of step out and, you know, and lead the way. So, yeah.
I want to answer it from another angle to give you, you know, we're tag teaming on this. I think one answer to your question as far as why aren't certain types of artists more promoted, one, you have a corporatization of the media. You have news organizations, ostensibly news organizations, that since they allow the news to become a profit center, it's driven by certain dynamics that are not going to comport with advancing your consciousness, let me put it like that, right? And let's take it from this angle. Let's say that you are the state. If you are the state, are you going to promote people and movements that go against your very existence? Let's be real when we talk about the power of the state, the U.S. state and any state, nation state. You know, there's certain power dynamics you have to face up to. At the same time, and this is something Greg and I talked about a while ago, it's really something how the way the system is set up, the neoliberal capitalist system is set up, it can take certain protests, let's say, and put that out there and incorporate the protests, and then, of course, they used to say this in the 60s a lot, co-op some of the leaders of that movement. So that's something that happens also. But it's not just about the media. It's not just about the state. It's about the people, too. And the people can
create their own champions.
Right.
Know, create their own underground.
Exactly.
Resist forms of resistance.
Right.
You know? And I mean,
right.
All that's going on in play, too. You know, I never feel like, you know, the powers that be are totalizing or deafening.
Definitely not.
You know, the quality of resistance or the caliber of reflection that goes on in the arts, you know what I mean? And what, you know, the thing is that we just have this succession or this procession of people who are like the Panthers, who are so successful at kind of flipping the media script. It's like they know, they were just so incredibly media savvy, you know, that they actually forced the media to come to them, you know, to tell their own story, you know, through that mechanism.
But then the media gets hip to it, and you know.
Well, I mean, you know, but I mean, you know, there's, again, I go back to, you know, this whole kind of invisibility, fugitivity conundrum that goes on. You know, it's like, you know, the culture just stays in kind of vertiginous, you know, regenerative motion. You know, it's always kind of, you know, building anew from the seeds of what was,
absolutely,
you know, as Tower of Power said, what was hip, you know, was hip today might soon become passé. You know what I mean? So that there's just a propulsive energy, yes, in the culture to keep it moving, to renew it, to not say it the same way it was said yesterday. Renew the, you know, the language, create a new audience, right, you know, that breaks, you know, generationally, you know, from the old. Yeah,
so. The power of consciousness and culture to deal with structural and social and economic and material dynamics.
Right. Right. Thank you. I want to thank you for an amazing evening. And thank you all for coming. We have a reception outside and, you know, a few things to nibble on and to continue the discussion through the evening, hopefully.
Thank you so much for having us.
Thank you so much. This was
thank you all for coming.
Really amazing.